Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Pakhuis de Zwijger via Salto or social media or our live stream at the website dezwijger.nl. And welcome to this expert session on the right to challenge the Amsterdam experience. A special welcome to all our international partners from across Europe that are part of the research project AB Cities and Future Proof Equilibrium. Well, that is the translation of a Dutch program, Toekomstbestendig Evenwicht. The right to challenge, in Dutch, uitdagerecht, is one of the best known examples of modern citizen participation. And by introducing community rights and by laying down what residents are allowed to do themselves, responsibilities of a municipality are democratized. This is fundamentally different than the conventional forms of citizen participation or consultation. This live stream session comprises of several conversations in which we will explore different dimensions of this important new democratic instrument. We will have a variety of researchers, practitioners, politicians, and they will share their findings and experiences. And we will showcase what has been achieved so far, in particular with an experiment in Plein 4045, an area here in Amsterdam, with a zero waste lab, and how the right to challenge has helped to execute the plans for and with a lively market. We will also discuss what the challenges and possibilities are for this instrument, the right to challenge, in the near future and, which I always adore here in Amsterdam, we will look at the development with the right to challenge in Rotterdam, a beautiful city here in the Netherlands. And of course, this is not a television show, it's a live stream, and the difference is that we actively encourage participants to join forces, and you are asked here and at home to participate by posting questions, providing comments, give feedback, and after every conversation, I will take a brief moment to actually address these questions and comments, and you can do that via the Q&A button in the lower part of your screen. The Zoom Q&A button. Probably after 15 months of Zooming, everybody knows how that works in academic life. So hopefully you do so. The program will take about 1.5 hours, and I hope that we can, really explore and learn together what the right to challenge actually provides in more democratization of cities. Let's look at a short clip to introduce this afternoon.
Buurtrechten. Amsterdam heeft buurtrechten. Maar wat zijn buurtrechten eigenlijk? En wat kan je ermee als ambtenaar en als initiatiefnemer? Met buurtrechten zet de gemeente een instrument in om afspraken te maken over het overdragen van taken aan bewoners. Initiatiefnemers komen met een plan. De gemeente biedt samenwerking, kennis, ruimte en geld. Er zijn 3 belangrijke buurtrechten. Met het Right to Challenge kunnen de bewoners de gemeente uitdagen om taken over te nemen. Zoals het runnen van een buurtcentrum, het bieden van opleiding en werk of het onderhouden van openbare ruimte en groen. Het Right to Bid geeft bewoners de kans een plan in te dienen voor het gebruik van een leegstaand pand van de gemeente. Dit kunnen bewoners dan ook zelf beheren. Zo krijgt het pand een functie die belangrijk is voor de buurt. Het Right to Plan geeft bewoners het recht om een plan voor de inrichting van hun buurt te maken. Waarom buurtrechten? Bewoners in Amsterdam zien kansen om de buurt socialer, groener, schoner, veiliger en duurzamer te maken. Ze bedenken slimme oplossingen voor opgaven in de buurt en leveren met hun initiatief impact en waarde voor de stad. De gemeente Amsterdam wil met buurtrechten bewoners ruimte geven voor het nemen van initiatief. Het gebruik van buurtrechten vraagt van ambtenaren en initiatiefnemers een andere manier van samenwerken. Een open en flexibele houding is belangrijk, want niet alles is in regels vast te leggen. Vaak is het een zoektocht naar oplossingen en blijven we steeds leren. Dat gaat met vallen en opstaan en vraagt denkwerk en creativiteit. Wat levert het op? Door samen te werken geven we goede ideeën van Amsterdammers de ruimte. Daar hebben meer bewoners wat aan. Samen maken Amsterdammers de stad.
Yes, a clip from the city of Amsterdam to introduce community rights. And you immediately also get the logos of the city and also their format for films, for video clips on their website. Good. Here in the studio in Amsterdam, our first speaker. He is the Alderman for Social Affairs, Diversity and Democratization of the city of Amsterdam. Give him a warm welcome from your home, Rutger Grootwassink. Welcome. You're the first alderman who has the official function in your title of democratization. In your opinion, what is the essence for of the right to challenge?
Well, I think that the essence is that responsibility for several tasks in the municipality can, of course, be done by civil servants. But I think that, and in a way, it was kind of maybe typical that in the clip we saw, and we both laughed at it, the civil servants were mentioned first, yeah. And residents were mentioned second. And I think that what the right to challenge can do is that it can change the power balance between residents and the municipality. And in a sense, it can contribute to, let's say, a more democratically owned, more democratically controlled tasks in neighborhoods. So I think that the right to challenge can be, and also the other civil rights can be, very helpful in strengthening the ownership of residents.
Yeah, it was interesting. So what is the benefit of community rights? Civil servants can cooperate. Yeah. So. These community rights, right to bid, right to plan, right to challenge. When you started your office, but it's a bit probably a bit American to phrase it like that. Why did you decide to start piloting on the instrument of right to challenge?
Well, because I think that the way that the municipality works and the way that civil servants work is in a sense a bit old school. And I think that there are all kinds of initiatives and all kinds of examples where we see that community rights have worked and have that a lot of neighborhoods have benefited from them. So I think that it would be nice to explore these community rights and to see if it also is helpful for Amsterdam. Mm-hmm. And I'm convinced that it can contribute to helping people to feel more ownership in their neighborhoods and also to maybe strengthen ties between residents as well.
And what happens if you say to the workers in the municipality, the civil servants, if you say, well, the way you've done business, the way you've conducted all your things is a bit old-fashioned, we're going to change. What happens when you say that?
I think there are several reactions. Some people agree totally. Some others, yeah, I think they scare the shit out of them.
Hmm. And what happened then?
Well, of course, I think that it, community rights isn't something that you just state that, okay, there are community rights, so let's go. So a lot of work needs to be done. But I'm dedicated to investigate and to explore if we can do this. And a lot of people are very enthusiastic about it. And some others think, why should residents do that? Isn't it our job? But yeah, I think that it's necessary to explore this.
Okay, so you announced this pilot program, and 3 years later, we're now in today. What are the challenges you and your team or democratization team faced with this right to challenge? What dilemmas did it bring up in introducing this new way of working?
It's there are all kinds of dilemmas. There are all kinds of legal dilemmas, for example. If you look at procurement, we are in very strict rules in procurement. There are,
from the European Union.
Yeah, there are EU guidelines, there are national guidelines. It's not that you can say, hey, if you want to do this, and it's higher than a
certain amount.
Than a certain amount, then you should use the procurement legislation. So procurement is quite complicated. Legal boundaries are quite complicated, but also cultural boundaries, because a lot of people still feel that why should residents do that themselves? Why it's way easier for us to do it?
Yeah, it's more efficient, probably.
Probably. But then you don't take into account the benefits that a neighborhood receives from it. You don't take into account the effect of the process of getting to do so, to do stuff like this. So I think that legal boundaries are the most difficult. But these are some of the things that we faced. And of course, you always have believers and non-believers. And that's why we try pilots to see if it works, but also to map in a way the difficulties that you face.
Yeah, and find solutions for them.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you said the reason why I wanted to do this is to give democratic control back to neighborhoods, to citizens. Did you achieve these goals?
Well, not yet. I mean, there are certain projects in Amsterdam that were, let's say, a right to challenge before we had the name Right to Challenge.
Huh? Yeah.
We have community buildings that are run by people themselves, and they work excellent. So I think that it's not that we're already there and that all the community rights are completely into legislation and that everyone who has a great idea can come to us. But I think that we had some breakthroughs and we are now making a policy plan how to implement. And I think I wanted to go a bit faster, but it's okay where we are now.
You wanted to go faster with what?
With implementing these community rights.
In the regular regulations
Yes.
of policies.
Yeah.
And is this still the ambition that what is the future of the right to challenge in government policies of the city of Amsterdam?
I think that the future is that the community rights will be embedded in all aspects of municipal of
the domains in which you are active. Really?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, because I'm convinced that if the basic thought is that residents will have as good of ideas or maybe even better ideas than you as a municipality as bureaucracy will have, then why should it be bounded to certain domains? I think why shouldn't it be possible in the social domain or in the physical domain? I think that maybe only no. I mean, if thinking about it, even when it comes to security, why shouldn't there be a possibility to have some citizen initiatives on security as well?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not easy to implement. Huh?
Yeah.
And you have to look at the domains, what barriers, because the barriers, for example, the legal barriers differ in domains.
Yeah.
But as
a principle
as
idea?
As a principle, I think that why shouldn't it be possible to have these rights in every domain?
And do you think that, I mean, you're in your last year of the term of your the current coalition in political parties which is running the city.
Mm-hmm.
Is this going to happen before you are out of office?
I hope that the policy document will be the city council will decide on this policy document. Yes.
And is there a majority in the city council for this fundamental idea?
Well, it's in our coalition agreement, so there should be. No, and I think that I think that it doesn't depend on this the majority that there is now. I think that the community rights are so vast among the discussions about the way municipalities are run.
Yeah.
That it doesn't depend on this coalition. It doesn't depend on me. It, I think that community rights are here to stay, and I think that if we can explore and collect experiences, I can't see why it shouldn't be.
Yeah. Okay, so because we're going to have that discussion the coming hour with practitioners and researchers who also have been part of these experiments, right? So if you would have to describe what the biggest difference is in a government which doesn't have community rights integrated in most of their domains, and a local government which has integrated community rights within all the domains which are possible. Mm-hmm. What is the biggest difference between these two mm-hmm. systems?
I think what is also essential in community rights is that it's also a way in which there's a permanent discussion and a permanent interaction of residents and citizens and a bureaucracy. Mm. And I think that this ongoing conversation is crucial. So I would think that.
So in your vision, this is a method. It's also a way for that permanent conversation between mm-hmm. citizens and their civil servants on what is.
On how a city should be run.
Yeah.
Yes, there are benefits for neighborhoods who can be very concrete. The neighborhood run building or something else, or the zero waste lab, which is very practical. But from a more abstract point of view, I think that this, in essence, community rights can have the effect of that the way that cities are run altogether should be altered.
Hmm. And that would really change. I'm still looking at these. I'm in my head now. 16,000 civil servants of Amsterdam are looking at this program. How would that? So what the change is the permanent conversation. But what? In what way would that? Their job change. I'm looking at.
Well, in a way that they should be more aware of a direct impact of their actions on residents.
Yeah, there's a constant conversation on the effects of policy and the way.
I think that bureaucracy can be a monster, but it's also a very functional system. But it tends to look into itself. It tends to get closed. And I think that this permanent conversation also on why are we doing this? Which values are underlying? That's crucial for any healthy bureaucracy.
It's a sanity check.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Okay. Now, we are going to especially look at the experiment of Plein 45 and the Zero Waste Lab. Did you visit it?
I visit Plein 40, 45 quite often, but I did, no.
You visited, you never visited the program.
Yeah, I had discussions. I've been there once and I had discussions with the people who took the initiative.
And were you happy with how this is this for you an experiment like you want to see many?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And why is it such an attractive experiment?
I think that it's very attractive because I like the underlying goals of it. Huh?
Yeah.
Zero waste, of course.
Yes.
But also, if you look at the market on Plein 4045, it's very interesting that it had a smaller conversation between the people, between the entrepreneurs, between the people who live near the market. This is also about conversation. This is about relations, and that's what what I find very attractive to in this experiment.
Exactly. So it's not only a conversation, a permanent conversation between the government or the municipality or the civil servants and the citizens or residents of Amsterdam. It's also a process in which all these residents and all these stakeholders of specific squares or specific places have to meet and have to discuss their vision on certain topics.
And have to negotiate and have to quarrel and have to celebrate.
Together, so this is your final year for your first term as an alderman. What is highest on your agenda to achieve the coming, if we talk about democratization?
Well, we're still working on a policy on participation. We are
there's a consultation about that going on right now.
Yes,
yeah?
We are working on the way that the local government is organized in the boroughs, which is also quite important.
Yeah, the Stadsdelen discussie.
Yes, but I think that if I look at my the program that we promised at the start of our of my term, most of the things have been done. We have participatory budgeting, we have all kinds of stuff, but yeah, community rights is high on the agenda.
Oh, nice. Thank you so much for this interview. And we will now go to a second video, and then I will interview two civil servants who have been part of this program, the project manager community rights from the municipality, and the area manager, or we didn't know the exact English translation, but omgevingsmanager of the New West City District, also of the city of Amsterdam. But we will now look first at a small clip introducing this Right to Challenge program there.
Mark Biro die heeft een hele groot probleem met afval. Wij zeggen tegen de gemeente, wij gaan niet alleen de logistiek willen veranderen, maar ook het scheiden willen wij anders kunnen doen. Milieubewust, vooral milieubewust, maar ook het kost ons heel veel, te veel. Er zijn collega's op de markt die helemaal geen afval hebben en alsnog heel veel moeten betalen. En er zijn collega's die bijvoorbeeld heel veel afval hebben en heel weinig moeten betalen, zoals de AGF. Als je naar de praktijk kijkt van de gemeente, dan zie je eigenlijk dat ze weinig ervaring hebben met dit soort dingen. En daarom zijn we in gesprek willen gaan.
We hebben nu wel twee perscontainers hier staan. Eentje voor karton en een andere container voor de rest. En ja, maar het is soms die machines werken soms niet, die lopen vast. En er komen vrachtwagens hierheen. Er wordt alles toch in één vrachtwagen gestort. Ja, het is gewoon nog niet zoals wij willen.
Wat wij slimmer gaan doen is, wij willen van de afval juist geld verdienen. Die wij produceren hier op de markt. Wij willen van de afval inkomsten kunnen brengen, zodat wij ook het milieu verbeteren zo en zo. En iets doen om ons zeg maar, een beetje minder pijn te doen in onze zak. Wij willen eigenlijk democratisch behandeld worden. Wij willen eigenlijk ook iets te vertellen hebben. Wij willen gewoon geen strijd aangaan, maar wij willen gewoon laten zien dat we samen willen werken met de gemeente. Dat is gewoon ons ding.
Ja.
Nou, hier ben ik weer. Wat ik dit keer wil vertellen over de afval is vervolg van wat we in de vorige shot hadden genomen over de plannen die we hadden met de afval. En we hebben die waar kunnen maken. De plastic kratjes die gaan terug naar de groothandels. Daar worden die weer hergebruikt. We hebben ook de AGF bakken. Die worden gevuld met AGF. En die gaat naar de bio vergister. En dan hebben we ook de pellets, de houten pellets. Die gaan ook terug naar de groothandels. En die worden weer hergebruikt. En niet meer afgebrand. En karton wordt ook gescheiden. Karton gaat bij de karton en de plastic afval gaat ook weer in de volgende container, restafval. dit is ons ook alleen maar gelukt door de buurtbudgetten die we toen hadden aangevraagd. En die we ook hebben gekregen. En dit is het resultaat van de buurtbudget. Dit is het resultaat van onze inzet. De buurt is er blij mee. De marktkoopmannen zijn er blij mee. De afvalconciërges zijn er ook heel erg blij mee. Iedereen is er blij mee. En nu is de vraag, wij willen het principe dat de vervuiler betaalt. En dat is onze challenge. De zero waste lab staat er nu, zoals jullie zien. En de vraag is naar de gemeente toe om de afvaltarieven eerlijk te verdelen. De vervuiler betaalt.
Yeah, that is a big cleanup. If you look at the before and after picture. Here in the studio for this first round of interviews on the real experiments of the right to challenge. Machteld Combe, she's the project manager community rights at the City of Amsterdam, and next to her, opposing her, Redouane Boussaid, city maker, area manager, vicinity manager, I don't know, omgevingsmanager in Dutch, of the New West City District. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you.
So it looks amazing. I mean, I asked the alderman, he said, community rights are here to stay, and I can imagine why if you look at the before and after photo. So what is, how did the right to challenge look at the 40plein 4045? What did you do? I mean, a clean, totally clean square.
Yeah. Yeah, we started with a big mess, just like you saw. The right to challenge of the market vendors plan 4045 is all about differentiated waste rates, yeah. And they pleaded for to fairly organize the rates. At this moment, the municipality of Amsterdam works with the principle of solidarity and one size fits all. So every market vendor has to pay similar waste rates. And in their opinion, that wasn't fair because you can't accept from a market vendor who has one bag of waste a week to pay as much as one who has tons of waste every week. So before getting to the right to challenge, they first told us that they were going to deal with the waste problem. And in order to do so, they created a zero waste lab. And as you see, they did organize all the waste. They separated the waste and they find local circular solutions for different waste. Begin of this year, they finished the zero waste lab. And as you see, it's a big achievement for the neighborhood, but also for all the challenges we face. After they finished the zero waste lab and it started working, they came with the right to challenge. So they asked the municipality, this is what we did, as you saw in the movie. This is what we did. So at this moment, we ask you, municipality, can you do something with the rates?
Yeah. And then the answer?
We are over here thinking about how to deal with the rates. That's not on me.
This is really a very good example, right? There is a policy. That policy has a waste policy. It is based on solidarity. Everybody pays the same amount. Then the entrepreneurs of a market come to you and they say, this is totally not solidarity. It's not. It has nothing to do with solidarity. It's unfair.
It's unfair.
Because people who have a lot of waste pay as much as little waste. Mm-hmm. And if we want to solve this problem, we have to do about something about the pricing mechanism, about the taxation.
Yes.
And we will show you that it's possible.
Yeah.
And they showed it's possible. Yeah. And now they say to the city, give us the right to organize ourselves this waste collection
yes.
and these taxation of that. Yeah. So a perfect example of a challenge, a right to challenge project. Is this the only right to challenge project in the city?
No, at this moment I have about, I think, six projects.
There's six Right to Challenge projects.
Yeah, six patents running. And what you see, this is a classical example of a Right to Challenge. Mm-hmm. They start out with something, they prove that it works, and then they take the next step. They say, okay, if we can do this, then the next step is we want to have a fair system.
Yeah.
I have also a project that provides local jobs to people in training. I have a project that rearranged the community garden, so they made the design and they're maintaining the garden themselves, and they build up the community more and more with that. We have communities that help other people who have debts to see if they can arrange it in a different way. All kinds of different.
Yeah. So also, like the alderman already say, on a very a diversity of domains,
yes,
citizens are actually using their right to challenge, and they say, we think we can do this actually better,
absolutely,
or actually more value based, or more successful,
more local,
more principled, or more with solidarity than you as a city government. What has been the biggest challenge in this right to challenge?
I think a major breakthrough. I think there are two things. I learned to see this challenge from their perspective and the perfect perspective of the market vendors.
You didn't do that before you.
Yes, I did, but
what changed?
What changed? They started to trust me. Uh-huh. So helping these market vendors to achieve the zero waste lab, which was their challenge and their message to the municipality that they also can figure out these kind of things, was all about trust. There was a gigantic gap between the municipality of Amsterdam and the market vendors. And in my opinion, if you place yourself in their shoes, they see a huge organization with 16,000 employees, with multi-billion budgets and several departments that say something about the market, and they are those small market vendors. So there was a big gap between how they see the municipality and how we want to deal with them. So in order to know their challenge and to deal with this challenge, We had to see this challenge from their perspective, and their perspective was a very simple one. They had already have a zero waste lab, a very small collection of separating the waste, but they weren't able to organize it in a professional way, just like they did now. That was one thing. So first of all, it was for me very interesting to see this challenge from their perspective. And the second one was budget. They, just like Hakim said in the movie, they pleaded for a neighborhood budget. They got the neighborhood budget, and that gave them an independent seat at the table. So it changed the roles. They didn't have to hold their hands to achieve this kind of thing. They had a plan. They have the money. And they asked the municipality to come have a seat at the table. So it was the other way around. And for us, the municipality, not for me in particular, but other departments, it was a strange happening, because the normal way of working is we have the budget, we have the plan, the structure. So if we want to consult these market vendors, we will. If we don't, we will not, because we are the only one who is responsible on the waste or other things. So when they had the money, so the neighborhood budget was a role changer for the market vendors, and it gave them a seat at the table as an equivalent partner. And this was for me a very important achievement. So they started to deal with us as a municipality. For me, it was a change of roles. One time I was with them, and one time I was with the municipality. But the budget was a big game changer.
Yes. So the money, the position, gave them a position of that they could actually negotiate with the municipality on what they wanted and they needed. And in that sense, it was a game changer.
This was their design. This was their design. They designed this.
Yeah. You showed the picture. Yeah, it's beautiful. And it's also because there are some European partners, of course, looking, and of course, the way we organize our municipality is different everywhere. But we have these vicinity or area managers, and your function actually is right to connect citizens to that big apparatus of the municipality.
Yes.
So that's why you also the way you just described your role. What sometimes I'm with the citizens, sometimes I'm with the municipality. That is actually your job of dealing with that. Yeah, interesting. So the neighborhood budget was the game changer in this. Do you recognize that you need a game changer?
Yes, you see this with all the challenges. They just start out with a plan. Eh? They start out with a local plan. They see something happening in the neighborhood that doesn't work out the way it should be working out.
Yeah.
And they make a plan to make it work better. And normal with a right to challenge, you have to transfer the budget that's on the... that's the budget from the municipality is transferred to the residents that have the plan. But that takes a long time. So before they get this budget, you need to do something to get them started up so they won't keep on working voluntarily and everything for free. So you need a budget to start up. And these neighborhood budgets, they work very well for that. So you have a starter. You can start up with your plan. You can make your plan grow. And you can show that it works, that it really works, what you worked out as a plan. So starting with a budget, you really need to do that to get going.
Yeah, interesting. They said in the clip, the market vendors, they said, we want to be taken serious. We want to be seen as citizens of this, and we want to take responsibility, right?
Yes.
The alderman said, this is here to stay. This different way of working. You are a civil servant, responsible for these community rights. Are your colleagues ready for that?
Not all of them, no. There you can see in different departments that different colleagues work with initiatives. They're used to this kind of working. They know that civil servants or that residents are able to do this, to pick up these tasks, and that they are capable of doing the things that they make plans for. There are also a lot of civil servants that work, as we say in Dutch, they work behind the bureau. They don't come out a lot in the streets or don't talk a lot
They like to work with paper as a...
Not all of them, but you can see the more you work in the streets, the more you meet up with residents, the more you talk to residents and find out what their plans are, or more you go out in the streets and find out how policy lands in the neighborhoods and what it does to people. The more you understand why it doesn't always work the way you thought of, the way you thought it would work. So, and that is why people make these plans, because they see something happening that doesn't work. And if you admit that as a civil servant, that as a government, your policy doesn't always do the thing that you want it to do, you understand why people have challenges and why they pick up this responsibility. And you will find out that they have the capacity to do this, and that it has impact on the neighborhood and the people who benefit from that. Hmm. So it's about understanding, it's about meeting people, it's about going out in the streets and finding out what it is.
Yeah.
And I can keep on explaining or writing papers, but it doesn't really work.
Yeah, but so the other one said it's actually facilitating a permanent conversation between civil servants and the citizens of Amsterdam. And you say, and that is really relevant because although you can have really idealistic vision in conducting or constructing a policy, the effects on the street, the effects of the of your policy, you need to see on the ground yourself what the, because then you can make better policies.
Yeah,
it's also yeah. it's also making your the apparatus can function better if you use these.
If you see it well, if you see it and if you make this policy with residents themselves.
Yeah,
because we think as a civil servant, we think in policy goals.
Yeah,
residents think in impact. What's my impact on the neighborhood? What's my impact on you living in this neighborhood?
Yeah.
What's the impact of green on people who live there, and can we change that? That's, you know, they think in stories, they think in issues, and we as policymakers, we think in big goals. Mm. So there's a big language gap between that of how we talk and think about how neighborhoods work and what we want to reach with what we do.
Yeah. How, so we, Redouan just told us what his learned lessons were, but also about his specific role as an area manager, omgevings manager. How relevant for successful right to challenge implementation is it that the area manager is the functioning like Redouan is functioning? I mean, really being the connection between these two domains.
Yes, well, colleagues like Redouan are very, very important for the municipality. You see everywhere in the areas of Amsterdam, you have people like him working there, and they have contact with people who live in the area. They know what is happening in the area. They know what's important for the area. They are talking to the residents. They have sessions and they make up the neighborhood plans together. So it's very important to have this knowledge of civil servants that know the people and know what's going on in the neighborhood and have the connections and the network in the neighborhood. Because only then we can understand what is happening and who is able to do something about it and what the network is. Because that's very important, that people who have plans also have a network in their neighborhood. You see these men on the market, they have a network in their market.
Yeah.
And that makes that the plan works and everybody supports it. So people who work in the area are very important for challenges.
Yeah, so I was wondering what are what kind of skills do you need as a in your function to be able to do this successfully?
First of all, social, speaking different languages and not literally the languages.
Although you speak many languages.
Not literally, but try to understand the struggle of a market vendor. I just came from the market, and during this corona, there was a lockdown also on the market, and one of the vendors just spoke to me and told me, I am not able to be 5 days on this market, only 2 or 3 days, but I have to feed 5 people. So how do you as municipality think about your role in this?
He's only allowed to work for 2 or 3 days because of
corona. Yeah, because of the crisis. The market is it in full range at this moment? So yeah, that is a question I can't answer. But being on this market and eating scrambled egg and drinking Moroccan tea with these market vendors gives me an insight in the way they live. So in my function, it is important to have trust, that people trust you. And it's vulnerable because I'm not trying to promise them everything, because I know how complicated it is to get things done in the municipality. And it's not because of my colleagues don't want to change things.
Sometimes systems function like
it's the system. Okay. This market, there are 5 departments with deal with this market. So yeah. Everybody has his own opinion, his own goal, his own. It is very important to be trusted, to give back this trust. But it makes me vulnerable a lot.
I understand. Yeah. What did the right to challenge this specific program or project brought to the neighborhood?
It brought a lot of positive vibe. I was at the neighborhood budget the day they received their budget, and they were one of the winners of the budget. They were very happy, and for the first time I saw them They knew there was a possibility for them to work with the municipality. So it was a thing they were always in a battle with the municipality, all but talking about them, don't understand us, don't want to work with us. So when they received their budget, they were okay. So it is possible to do this kind of things. So the first thing they did is the zero waste lab, and I hope that they can achieve the differentiated waste rates.
Yes.
Because if they don't, the chance is big that they will say, "Ah, you see,
it doesn't work."
It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Yeah. The municipality isn't a partner with us for us. We can trust them, and they will fall back in a kind of old rhythm, distrust and.
Clear.
And yeah.
We have two questions from Lucas. The first was to Rutger, but was actually I kept it for you because he was asking whether Amsterdam is looking also to other municipalities. Who are using the right to challenge? Are you learning from each other?
Yes, we are. Yeah, I'm working together with Rotterdam. You will see later on. Utrecht, Tilburg, recently Arnhem is joining, and we're learning a lot from each other because Rotterdam is quite far. They already have a policy and
work
method. Yeah. So you can learn from what they are doing and from other challenges.
We're going to talk to the project manager, your colleague from Rotterdam, later in this program. The other question is also from Lucas, and he says, if residents challenge the municipality with a new idea because they think they have a better or easier way to achieve it, who or what is the judge of that idea? How does the municipality evaluate their own ideas or interests against that of the residents? So who is judging whether...
I think this is always a discussion. Because we have policy, and this policy should provide that citizens... can benefit from them. Mm. These plans come up because they don't always do that. And if we keep making rules, if we build up a policy right now and we put in all those rules that we already have, it doesn't work. So you have to make it very light. So you say, like, okay, this is an area manager. He knows these people. They have a good plan. Is this good for the neighborhood? Are they able to do this? Do we think this is a good plan? And can we?
Can they achieve it?
Yeah. Can they manage it? Then you should say, well, let's do this. Because you never say, okay, you have the plan. Okay, here's the responsibility and here's the money.
You talk.
You do it in steps, okay. And then you make the agreements. So if you make the agreements in front, you actually, the challenge doesn't work anymore.
Thanks. Interesting. Thank you so much for telling us a bit more about how the city of Amsterdam is dealing with the right to challenge in general, but also this beautiful example in the market in New West. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
The third round of interview, the second with two persons, is with researchers. We'll introduce them, but first we will look at a clip again. Thank you.
De stad staat nooit stil, maar is altijd in ontwikkeling. Maatschappelijke vraagstukken genoeg. Sommige klein, andere juist groot en complex. Gelukkig is de stad vindingrijk. Overal is energie. Iedereen heeft ideeën. Maar om vooruit te komen is samenwerking nodig. Burgers, maatschappelijke organisaties, bedrijven en overheden. Ieder heeft een stukje van de puzzel in handen. Dat kan uitdagend zijn. Want hoe kom je vooruit als er verschillende wensen zijn en verschillende belangen? Hoe breng je dan partijen samen en ga je van een goed idee naar uitvoering? Wij helpen onze partners om antwoord te vinden op deze vragen. Samen werken we aan hun ambities, dilemma's en conflicten. Hoe we dat doen? Via praktijkgericht onderzoek rondom concrete innovatieprojecten. Bijvoorbeeld op het gebied van energietransitie, inclusief bouwen of de flexibele arbeidsmarkt. We creëren rijke leeromgevingen, ontwikkelen en delen kennis. Hier betrekken we ook onze studenten bij, als de probleemoplossers van de toekomst. Ons doel? Samen met betrokken partijen positieve verandering realiseren. Want samen maken we de stad.
In de stad. studio, Stan Major, Lector, Coordination of Urban Issues at the Center of Expertise, Urban Governance and Social Innovation at the Amsterdam University of Applied Sciences. Welcome to you. And across from you, the PhD researcher of Urban Governance and Social Innovation at the AUAS and University of Amsterdam, Joachim Meerkerk. Warm welcome to you. So, Joachim, you are. What is your PhD research about?
I'm researching the collaborative management of, in this case, Plein 40, 45, but more of urban areas in the city.
Yeah, but you are focusing on researching this particular experiment we just talked about.
I've been working on this case for 3 years now. Yeah.
Collaborative governance. Okay. And what is your role as a researcher when there is a right to challenge experiment going on like there is in Plein 4545? What do you do?
I'm doing action research, so I take on a very specific role, and that is that I'm very intensely working with Redouan and Machtold to get things done on the square, and I'm also working with the entrepreneurs of the market. So, the last year it was a bit problematic with the corona situation, but before I was at least once a week on the square and working with them to get and to help them. And
yeah, so you're researching the project, how it goes, what works, what doesn't work, but you also help actually actively and give advice on how they can actually be a successful project.
Yeah, and sometimes it's really like concrete helping in something that they need to get done, but most of the time I help them specifically to achieve what they want to achieve through collaboration. Yeah. So I'm continuously looking at their plan is now to do this, and I'm working with all the stakeholders, so I'm looking at all the plans, and I'm thinking, okay, how does this contribute to their ambition to achieve this zero waste lab in a form of collaboration, and give them feedback on what to think about and what they can do differently.
Yeah, so also a function of reflector. You give reflection on what they are actually wanting to achieve and what
that's
your ideas.
Most important part,
Stan, what is the role of the AUAS on in experiments like these? I mean, do you do that often? I mean, action research, is that part of your normal working methods?
Yes, certainly. What we try to do is we are based in Amsterdam,
yes,
and we are connected to the city. So we are working in all kinds of places in the city, like this square, but also many other places where we think that there are important urban issues and where there are important innovations taking place. And as we have learned already today, when there are innovations, there is trouble. There's learning.
Always.
Almost always.
Yeah,
there should be. We think it's important to sort of help out, bring in knowledge. We have a little bit of different roles, as Joachim already explained. So it's not so much a traditional role of a researcher as sort of a bystander, sort of observing.
Yeah.
But it's
like
more
a fly on the wall.
Yes, and then
not really there.
And then writing an academic piece about it.
Yeah.
It's also a valid form of research. But what we try to do specifically in this situation is to be active, to be visible, to become a trusted partner there, but also to be critical sometimes, to be helpful, to bring in knowledge from outside, and generally speaking, to create some sort of more structured learning situation.
Yeah.
Because I think there's a lot of learning going on there. First of all, from these market vendors. Second, of all these institutions around it. But the big problem is that this learning can sort of disappear.
Yeah, fade away into universe. Yeah.
It's if it's not written down, if it's not codified, if it's not shared.
Yeah.
So therefore, a role of us as a knowledge institution is very much to sort of make a professional learning environment from this area.
And do the participants in these experiments Do they realize that they are now part of a structured learning environment? Do these market vendors, if I say, you are now in a structured learning environment, are you aware of that, are they?
I don't think so, but we can ask Joachim.
They are, but probably not if you use these kind of words.
No, of course.
Like what Redouan said about
languages.
Having to speak different kind of languages.
Yes.
Well, on Plan 45, it would be easy to speak Moroccan as well, but it's more speaking this language of the street.
Yes.
That is helpful there.
Yeah. So, interesting. And if you, as a University of Applied Science, where you say we're doing a different kind of research than the academic research, how is this? I mean, I can imagine that these projects then function better, maybe, or are more successful, but in a more structured way. If you look at the development of the city, what does it bring society if you are there as an institution to actually create these structures, the environment of learning? Love it.
Well, I mean, you should also ask them, of course.
Yes.
But
in a normal phrase sentence, yeah.
Yeah. I think it shows, hopefully it shows our commitment to the city.
Yeah.
It shows specifically our commitment to places where we think that something is needed.
Yeah.
I mean, this square which is central today is not in the most privileged neighborhood of Amsterdam. It's a place where there are a lot of intertwined problems, economic, social, safety. But where there's also a lot of effort from all kinds of parties to do something. So it's actually a place, if you go there, there's a big sort of demand for innovation. And I think it also can help if you join as a University of Applied Science in a sort of emancipatory way.
Yeah.
Because that's what I actually found very touching in also the video. I mean, it's market vendors, and also Redouan talked about it. They feel very little in a huge system of actors around them. If this helps them to sort of stand up for their rights, organize themselves, I mean, it's a super powerful achievement.
It's beautiful. And do you feel that the other partner, in this sense, the city of Amsterdam, is receptive to your findings, your suggestions, your learnings?
Well, it has been pointed out by different speakers before us that we see a sort of a two different worlds within the municipality of Amsterdam. And there's a smaller part of it that's very receptive.
Yeah.
The fear is, of course, also that you only talk with this part.
Yeah.
It's the people that work for the aldermen. That's the people that are often in the street. It's the people that are from the democratization team. But there's a huge rest of the
democratization team. No, yeah.
And these are mostly convinced. But
yeah.
there's a big back office of also of the municipality, which is harder to convince.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying that they should also all be convinced, because the story is a bit complicated. I mean, the municipality is a complex organization with many different roles. But one of the goals of our research is also to better understand this inner workings of the municipality.
Yeah.
And to understand what sort of more systemic change is needed.
Yes.
If you want to make this more like a sort of a mainstream development and not only an exception.
Yeah. So let's look at that, the systemic changes. I mean, I try to address this a bit with the alderman, mm-hmm. right? What his vision and ambitions mm-hmm. are with community rights, like the right to challenge and the introduction, and into the government processes. What according to your findings, but also your analytical work on this research you're doing, is necessary to make the right to challenge a success or even a standard instrument in the way government functions?
Well, it's different things, because, I mean, the right to challenge is an instrument for democratization. And I believe that it's it can be a very good instrument, but you asked Redouan how did writer channels help, and his answer was strikingly, it brought a good vibe, brought good energy to the square. And I think that the question is, I mean, you can do that with a lot of different kinds of instruments, bringing a good vibe. And the question is, what kind of mechanisms are set or are start working when you have a right to challenge?
Yeah.
And on Plein 4045, what we saw is that there are different elements that could be part of the right to challenge and that showed that they are working, like the creating a budget and mm-hmm. for the entrepreneurs to show what they are able to do is very important because it will bring trust mm-hmm. with the other stakeholders. The other thing is that you need some kind of support. Redouan has been supporting the entrepreneurs. I've been supporting them for 3 years. Machtelt is helping them in the last couple of years.
Yeah, so money well. Support system, yeah.
What has been lacking is mandate.
Okay.
So at some point they said, yeah, we are a right to challenge and we want to do things. We help them and we help them to achieve this and to achieve this. There was a lot of working with people in that area. And yeah, maybe there were conflicts and we helped to resolve the conflicts, et cetera, et cetera. But then the end question that they propose is, now we want to change the way that the tariffs are calculated. We want the polluter to pay. And then they sort of are starting to interfere with a policy which is not specifically made for that square. And it's a broad policy. And to change this policy, there's a whole system in place. So you need to evaluate the policy, and then you need to discuss the outcomes with all kinds of actors. And then there's a political debate about it. And then there's a new policy making process. And then you have to make a decision. So it takes 3 years for the levy to change.
Yeah.
And they're saying, yeah, but we want to do it tomorrow. Yeah. We want to have it tomorrow because we already solved our problems. Now you help us solve the rest of the problems. And what you see is here is that very often in these kind of places, we talk a bit with a bit of laughter about these civil servants that say, yeah, well, computer says no, can't do that. But actually they are very competent in what their organization is asking them
to do. Yeah, they are actually performing the way they should perform. Asked them, we mandated them to create systems where, for instance, levies or tariffs or are actually done rigorously and by a very organized system to change them.
The system and the procedures, they say you can't change that overnight.
No.
It's if it's a good idea, it doesn't really matter. There's a whole process to do that. So,
and that has his merits. That kind of thinking has merits.
Yeah. And, but on the other hand, the municipality, and especially the alderman, is saying, we want to do that. We want to act in a different way. We want to democratize this process and make it more participative.
Yes. Do it faster, he says.
Do it faster or do it in a different way.
Yeah.
Listen to what the people there ask you to do and collaborate with them to achieve these goals, which are more important than the processes or the protocols. So, the most important finding, I think, of the research is that if you want to take this democratization serious, if you want to take the right to challenge serious, you have to align the system to that. You have to change the system. And that's sort of that's a process that is about learning to do it differently. It's about changing culture, but not only the culture, it's also about the theories that you use. It's about thinking differently of how you want to deal with, the principle of equality, for example.
Yes.
And it's also about how do you make decisions.
Yes.
So I was laughing because you and the alderman were laughing about that the movie said something, or the film said something about civil servants. And it's, yeah, it's about... I was laughing because it doesn't say anything about politicians.
No.
And it just keeps politicians out of the equation of democratization.
Yeah, it's just about the dialogue between the system. And you said, where is the politics in this?
Well, it starts with the politics, because it starts with the way how decisions are being made. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the whole process that is set in place to sort of give that a place.
Jeroen Jonkers is also watching this show and wants to ask you the question. He's a very famous city maker and civil servant, I think, now, right?
Working on Plein 4045 as well.
So you are known. But what role can the Knowledge Institute play in testing new narratives, his question is, e.g. showing public value? Because without a good why, the narrative, it will be difficult to move the larger system for a longer time. And it's probably necessary, for instance, if you want to change this levy. So what role can Knowledge Institute play in testing new narratives?
Well, what we are trying to do, and that's where the mandate of the alderman is also lacking, is organize what we call an experimental learning environment. And in other terms, is we want to open up the debate.
Yeah.
We want to open up the debate about what kind of values are underneath the system that is in place. What kind of theories do we use, and how do we, what kind of structures or protocols are there in place, and which function do they have?
Yeah.
Which function do they serve?
Why do we have this rule? Yeah.
Yeah, and that's the debate that we want to open up. And I'm inviting also the aldermen to enter that debate and to start having a conversation about that. And I think that is one thing that that is our role, to facilitate those kind of debates.
Yeah.
So, he said it, hey? He said we need to have deep conversations about the values that we have. Well, start doing that.
Yeah, well, I hope... Well, some of his civil servants are here and they probably speak to him. Last question. Mm-hmm. What... In specific, this research, right, because you are a lecturer, you have a lecturer, you do oversee many research, probably. But what is most relevant in this research for you, for your institute, but also for society as a whole?
What I find super relevant is that it's an attempt to make more context-specific policies.
Yeah.
Specifically for this square, not, with these people.
Not general for entire city.
Yeah, so this is a pressure, of course, because we maybe come out of a period where there's a lot of centralized policies.
Yeah.
Also, how to organize markets, how to organize waste in the city. And this is an effort to do it more intelligent in a way, context-specific, closer to the real people around there. This is interesting to follow, and this relates back to many issues in the city, I think.
Yeah.
This conflict between context specificity and the input of local stakeholders, and a sort of the image of we have to work efficient, we have to treat every case equal.
There shouldn't be a difference whether you live in the north of Amsterdam or the south or the west. Every policy has the
same... And of course, there's a reason behind this thinking, but this is very interesting, I think.
Yeah.
And the second thing that I find very interesting is that it's quite unique what we're doing here in research terms, that we have a researcher, Joachim, I have to give him all the credits, who really follows a process for many years, established deep contacts. And that's a really interesting way of doing research.
Yeah.
Most research nowadays is also quite superficial. Mm. You do a lot of case studies, and then you're gone.
Yeah.
And if you really want to understand the situation, create trust, create impact, somehow we have to reorganize research also.
Interesting.
To make such type of research possible.
Yeah. I mean, really being there for a long time, create relationships, because and then you have to be there for the long time, right? Long term, Interesting. So it's also giving you a new perspective on what research can be or should be organized. Well, interesting. Thank you so much for giving us this insight in how research can actually play a really big role in introducing new democratic instruments in the city. Thank you so much. Because we're going to go to the last conversation of this afternoon, and that is the lessons learned in a broader context. As already mentioned, we have the honor that the coordinator or the program manager of the Right to Challenge of the City of Rotterdam is joining us. And although I live in Amsterdam for quite a long time, I always love to talk to people in Rotterdam. And for those who are internationally watching, internationally guests in this live cast, I mean, there is kind of like a competition going on between Amsterdam and Rotterdam all the time. But okay, I always love talking to people from Rotterdam. So a warm welcome to Ines Balkema. She's here via video conference. And the other person, also via video conference here, is the coordinator of the network Right to Challenge, Thijs Harmsen. A warm welcome to both of you.
Thank you. Yeah. You are also always so nice to me, and I'm very happy to be here.
Yeah, we've talked a few times, because if we talk about democratization, sometimes Amsterdam thinks they are so far, but I always say, well, look at Rotterdam. Okay, Ines, can you relate to the experiences we just talked about here in Amsterdam on the Square 45? Did you recognize aspects of your learnings in Rotterdam?
Yes, I can totally relate.
Yeah.
And I'm really happy to talk about this subject. I have been living Right to Challenge for the past 7 years. So I can totally relate.
Mm.
Do you want me to tell something about the success factors in Rotterdam? Or?
Yes.
Yes. Now, everybody understands that Right to Challenge is very sensitive. Because when someone else tells you, I can do your job better than you, there are not many people happy about this. And then, which makes it even more sensitive, is that Right to Challenge is about giving away the budget that belongs to the job. And then in Rotterdam, we give away the budget, not temporarily, but structural. So you lose part of your tasks, you lose your budget. And when we started to think about the design of Right to Challenge, we understood that if we wanted to make Right to Challenge a success, we needed some pushing power. We needed, and for this purpose, we set up a platform which consists of managers of the different departments and is chaired by a director. So this platform is very high up in our organization. And they make the integrated decisions. They advise our eldermen about whether or not to accept the challenge.
Yes. So you say that is what Joachim was mentioning about the mandate, right? You said,
yes,
we organize this internally with a high-level commission chaired by a director, which gives like authoritative, gezaghebbend advice to the aldermen.
Can I please finish?
Yeah,
there
of course.
Two things very important. One of the things is you want an integrated decision. You don't want the department that is challenged to make the decision on his own. Because, you know, I just told you, you're losing part of your task, you're losing part of your budget. This is sensitive. And then the other thing is you don't want civil service to make the decision. It happened lots of time to me that there was a challenge and a colleague would tell me, oh no, this task isn't for Right to Challenge, it can't be challenged. And then I'm very happy that I can tell them, it's not up to you to make this decision. It's up to the elderman. They will make the final decision. And if you want to stop this challenge from happening, you have to bring up really good arguments.
Yeah, it's very clear. Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. And so you say, because it's so sensitive, make sure that the department which is challenged is not making decision, but also make sure that politics are involved. It's exactly one of the conclusions actually Joachim brought up in doing his research in this in the Amsterdam case. So
there's one more thing. Is that what we talked about before is that there's this challenge. But the challenge is not only about the tasks they challenge. It's about social aspects. It's about what's happening in the neighborhood. It's about people getting to know each other. It's about people helping them. It's about ownership. So when you make a decision about a challenge, it's not only about what the challenge does for the department. It's about what the challenge does for the city.
Yeah, it's beautiful. That's why you want this integrated vision, because it achieves so much more values than just the things which are challenged. Let me go to Thijs Harmse, who is the coordinator of the network Right to Challenge. If you, with all your experience of this Right to Challenge in the Netherlands, or even worldwide, what would be your biggest recommendations to the team here in Amsterdam on implementing this Right to Challenge in a formal way, right? I mean, just being part of regular policy making.
Yeah. I will give you an answer. I will first explain what the network Right to Challenge is. It's a network where inhabitants, social enterprises, civil servants, and so on, work together and learn with each other how can we develop Right to Challenge in the Netherlands. And we help communities, we help provinces and municipalities with the implementation of Right to Challenge. Now, then your question. I think the developments in Amsterdam are very interesting. It's an approach with the community and with entrepreneurs of the square, Plein 4045. And also their aim to recycle their waste is very interesting. What are the important points that we can learn for inhabitants and community groups in Amsterdam? First of all, I think the local government has to explain how you can contact them for a Right to Challenge. Hmm. How they can help them to go to the local authorities and say, well, we would like to challenge your work. The civil service have to help them with their plans. For instance, Ines does in Rotterdam. But it's also necessary to have a clear decision-making process for the municipality, for the interested organizations, and for the citizens. That is very important for Amsterdam and also for all other municipalities in the Netherlands. And the last thing is, you have to find this information, how you can use Right to Challenge on the website of the municipality. And you have to find a phone number where you can get more information and so on and so on. Make it very simple for inhabitants to connect the municipalities and to find more information. And make a very clear process for your challenge, how to get contact, how to send your information to the local authorities, and the decision making process must be very clear too.
Yes, and in your experience, I mean, I was asking the alderman, right? I mean, what is the most important benefit of next to maybe a better product, better service, a cleaner market, for instance, in this case. But what's the biggest advantage? And he says the permanent conversation between policymakers and citizens, right?
That's very important. But the permanent conversation is very important because people know how they would like to live in their own neighborhood. So give them all the opportunities with Right to Challenge to decide and to organize their own environment, organize that for them, and give them the opportunity to have their budget for maintenance of public space, for instance. Mm-hmm. So they can organize their own service by their own, with participation of all the inhabitants, local companies, and the municipality.
Yeah.
So you need a lot of conversation and discussion and cooperation with each other. That's very important.
And if we would do this in a broader sense, and I mean, the element was saying in much more domains than we actually are doing. And Ines, I will ask you the same question.
Okay.
What would then change in society if this instrument is actually integrated in a serious way in regular government policy?
Oh, the change would be that this means another way of cooperation and coordination with participants and municipalities. So the change would be that civil servants have to step back and listen to inhabitants, what they would like be done in their neighborhood. So they have to listen more and more to people and to implement these decisions and work together with this or with this social initiatives. And I think it's very important that we that the satisfaction among inhabitants will increase in their own neighborhood. That's also a very important part of Right to Challenge.
Yes, interesting. Ines, what is in your way the biggest benefit? I mean, what would change fundamentally if this Right to Challenge would be a normal thing to do in all domains of government policy or of policy?
Now, what I think is that Right to Challenge really helps municipalities to change. It is an instrument that forces policy makers to work on an equal level with initiatives. And what we do in what you really have to understand that it's really hard for civil servants to let go of their tasks. It's also really hard for people who want to challenge the municipality to step up and to challenge. It's a big step because you get all this verantwoordelijkheid, how do you say
responsibility.
This?
Responsibility.
Responsibility on your shoulders. So what we do in Rotterdam is that we tell people who want to challenge us, don't write out a challenge. If you have an idea about what you want to challenge, pick up the phone, send me an email, and I will check if it is a current task, if you have money on our, if you have budget for this task, and then I will put you on the table with the people who work for the departments, but also with the people who work in the neighborhoods. Earlier on, we talked about this Right to Challenge is for some civil servants harder than for others. And you should put these both groups on the table. And then when you are sitting there with the people who want to challenge, you can talk about what is the task about, what is your experience, which talents do you bring in, how can we make this a success by working both on it. They don't have to take over the whole task. They can tell us, you know, this is what we like and this is what we are really good in, but we would like you to still do this part. And then we can do it together.
I also
think we should. The name Right to Challenge is not the right name.
Yeah, what's your suggestion for that? Because I think you have an excellent suggestion for that.
Now, I really would have liked to call it Right to Cooperate.
Yes.
You know, we are working together. We are bringing talents together. We see that we can make the city better by working on it together.
Yes.
And so but it's still called Right to Challenge in Rotterdam, but it's the way we do it is we sit together, we talk about it, we get to know each other, there is trust, and we work on it together. And, you know, if you are challenged, you might not like it, but if someone starts asking you questions about your job and about your knowledge, you really like to share this. And then you'll notice that the person who wants to do the challenge knows a lot about this subject too. And then you get a really nice interaction.
Thijs Harms, what do you think about, I mean, calling Right to Challenge, Right to Cooperate?
Well, I don't mind the name. I don't mind the name. What's very important is that it gives you the opportunity to citizens, to social enterprises, to other organizations, to cooperate with the authorities and to make better plans and to make better environment. one of the biggest right to challenges in the Netherlands is, for instance, started not by inhabitants, but by farmers in the Netherlands, in the province Friesland, where an agricultural organization and environmental groups work together with each other, and they say to the province of Friesland, we can develop nature reserves in cooperation and with a bigger role for farmers and inhabitants and with less money. Well, that's a very interesting project. It's the biggest right to challenge in the Netherlands at the moment.
What's the name?
I will say it in the Fries language. Natuur met de Mienskip.
Yeah.
Nature development in cooperation with
the community.
Farmers and inhabitants.
Yeah, Mienskip
so more
society.
More than 1,000 yeah. hectares in, which they want to, which they would like to develop.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. They have to challenge the province. They said we can do this work better. We can do this work cheaper. Well, they have now the possibility for a pilot period to develop their own approach.
Yes.
Okay.
Thijs, do you think the right to challenge should have a legal status? That
yes.
You. Why?
Yes. Yes. Because it's very important that there is a legal status for right to challenge, so that all the inhabitants have the opportunity to cooperate, to work together with provinces or with municipalities, and each municipality can develop their own rules for right to challenge. But there must be a small legal base for it. Yeah.
Ines, what is your perspective on that?
Yes, this is really nice because I have a totally different perspective on this. You can put right to challenge in a law and think that you have created a regulated access to the instrument. And I don't think that's the case. The instrument can only be successful if the organization being challenged believes in the instrument. Otherwise, it's easy to find a reason to reject challenges. You know, in Rotterdam, we don't even have a regulation for right to challenge. In Rotterdam, it's a policy instrument.
It's an approach in Rotterdam.
It's an approach. It's a policy instrument, and we choose to do it this way because we need flexibility. Because it is a policy instrument, we have space to be flexible within the framework.
I'm a supporter of your approach in Rotterdam.
Please let me finish.
Yeah,
we have really done our best to keep the framework of right to challenge as simple as possible. But for every challenge we have accepted, we had to deviate from the framework at some point. For example, we have taken on a challenge that costs more than the available budget. This is our show challenge. People have heard about it, the Schepenstraat. This is the people designed their own street. And we also have a challenge from applicants without a legal position. This is a very small challenge. And the applicant said, you know, we want to take over and we want to do the work in our garden between the houses, but we don't want a legal position because this costs a lot of money. And then I talked to the departments within the municipality and I asked them, do we really need this legal position? And they said, no, you know, this is a small budget and there are not very much risk. There's no risk. So we could give them this challenge without a legal position. So I think it's right to challenge is a difficult subject. It's a big step for our challengers to take. And you should be happy with everyone who steps forward and says, we want to challenge the municipality. And then you should make it as easy as possible. And that's the best thing you can do is don't regulate.
Okay, I'm going to leave it at that. I mean, this is just to show that the discussion of right to challenge hasn't ended at all. It's just started, and we should have much more learnings, discussions, open and deep conversations. Thank you so much for participating in this learning experience. Ines Balkema and Thijs Harmsen, thank you so much for sharing your experiences. Great to see you again by video, hopefully live next time. Yes, and of course, I would like to thank our guests, all of our guests today, and our audience, because thank you for your reflections and questions. You've also contributed to actually a very valuable learning experience, because of course this is organized by the University of Applied Sciences and the Gemeente Amsterdam, so I have to say this is a learning experience for me. And if you would like to continue the discussion or just simply want to stay informed about the outcomes of the research or the development of new projects at the AUAS or participate in future learning sessions, just leave your email address in the live stream details on the chat in Zoom, or follow them on LinkedIn. Look at HVA, Hogeschool van Amsterdam /urban governance, and you can or email secretariaatum@hva.nl. On behalf of the University of Applied Sciences, the Hogeschool van Amsterdam and the Gemeente Amsterdam, thank you for attending this live stream and have a great evening in hopefully a sunny part of the world. Thank you.